That foul ball brought to you by Edward Jones financial advisor Gavin Reed. That one brought to you by Dr. Leonardo Rios Anderson at Arctic Oral Surgery. Now batting for the Chinooks, a redshirt freshman left fielder from the University of Northern Colorado, number 22, Johnny Graham.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I think we're live again. So I do have to apologize, but the computer died that we used to do the streaming. It's a very old computer, and I've been telling the people that work around here that if it literally ever came unplugged while it was working or while we were working, it would quite literally last 5 minutes. And I don't know exactly how long it was unplugged before we realized it, but it. We didn't realize it in time, and the stream went down. So we just finished getting everything back up, so I do apologize for that. So for those of since everybody missed, what happened at the top of the first, Shooty pitched a 1-2-3 top of the first, and as you can see here, the Chinooks have two on and nobody out here.
That foul ball brought to you by Chepo's Mexican
against the Pilots. So, Will Batts singled to open up the ball game on, I believe, the first pitch of the game. And then John Mark Mullins drew a walk. And after conclusion of this at bat, I'll go over the defense and lineups for the Pilots today. That one is in there for a called strike three. So Graham goes down looking. And that'll be the first out of the game. So Hayden Keller will step up to bat. So let's quickly go over the defense and lineups for the Pilots today. Blake Wink playing second base and batting leadoff. Devin Lopez at shortstop today, batting second. Nick Hagedorn in left, batting third. Ethan Mann back in the lineup, batting fourth and playing right field. Wire at third base, batting fifth. Cole Escher in center, batting sixth. Alec Jones behind the plate, batting seventh. Michael McNamara, the first baseman, batting eighth. And Grant Wise, the designated hitter, will be batting ninth. Easton Sikorsky will be on the mound, or he is on the mound currently, for the Pilots. As that one is flown out to left field, and that will land foul. So once again, we do apologize for the issues regarding the stream so far, but we do, does look like we have things back under control here. We taped the charger to the computer for the night so that we make sure that it doesn't come unplugged again. Again, we do apologize for that. And that 1-1 is tapped, and that's going to get over the head of Lopez. And unfortunately, because Will Batts had to make sure he didn't catch it, he will hold it third, but Hayden Keller continues his hot hitting, as he will get aboard with another base hit. So now they will have bases loaded. Bases loaded and one out for Colby Ferris, the redshirt freshman from Tarleton State in Texas. So for those of you who are here just for the interviews, we have a studded day for you guys, as we have a lot of interviews going on today. In the top of the second inning, we will be joined by pitching coach for the Chinooks, Troy Hervey, in what will probably be his last interview of the season, as he is leaving next week, as he has a job back home that he's going to get started with. So certainly show your appreciation for him when he does come in here. In the, I do believe, the third inning, we are going to have a very special guest as a current University of Alaska Anchorage Chancellor Sean Parnell, and also former state representative and governor. He will be joining us in the third inning, so certainly a different interview than you guys are going to be used to, but we're definitely excited to have him. In the fourth inning, we are going to have a dueling interview as both Joe Kiel and Paddy McKermitt will be joining us. There are only two headsets, so they will be having both headsets, and I will be using the crowd microphone, so I'm not exactly sure how that's going to go or how that's going to sound, but we're going to try our best as that one is tapped into center field and a sliding catch in shallow center field. As Cole Escher was playing so far in, it was amazing. I couldn't believe that he got to that ball, but a great catch from him. So Colby Ferris, unfortunately, comes up empty-handed. So now, with two outs here, Pate Fullerton represents a golden opportunity for the Chinooks as he hopes to get something into that outfield to score at least one run here for the Chinooks. But at the very least, no matter what, they certainly have made Easton Sikorsky work very hard in this inning. And the first pitch to Fullerton is in there for a called strike one. And the 0-1 is swung on and tapped up the middle. And Blake Wink will field that. Flip on to second base for the third out of the inning. So the Chinooks come up empty-handed with the bases loaded here. But they do make Sikorsky throw a lot of pitches in the first. So a decent start for the Chinooks, although I'm sure they would have loved to come up with something there. But either way, Nelson Schutte will go back out there after a good first inning for him. And so the Chinooks will look to keep the Pilots offense at bay when we come back in the top of the second. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network. Is that first pitch? A little bit of chin music there for Ethan Mann as that one's in there for ball one. But I'm joined here by a very special guest, pitching coach for the Chinooks, Troy Hervey, in for his second interview of the season. Coach, how are you doing today?
Doing fantastic. Can't complain. Beautiful evening at Lee Jordan tonight.
Absolutely. So, obviously, Nelson Schutte on the mound tonight. Is there anything that you specifically told him, as that one will be a very long strike?
We'll take it. Left side of the line, we'll take it.
Absolutely. So is there any specific things that you guys worked on or went through before today's game specifically?
Yeah, so last time Schutte was out, struggled a little bit. Obviously, we wanted to make some adjustments. We kind of scrapped the Vulcan change. It's something that he'd been trying out. Wasn't really working for him. Went to more of a circle change. Seems to be more effective for him. This is his first time throwing it in a game. Just trying to get him to relax a little bit on the mound. He's got good stuff. We added a sinker in there, trying to see how that's working out for him. But really just trying to work more straight to the plate. He has a tendency to throw across his body a little bit, so we're trying to just make sure he's driving straight to the plate rather than throwing across. But he's a very coachable kid. He wants to get better. That's why he's up here. And I think you saw it in the top of the first. You know, his command looks better. His mound presence seems to be better. And I think, too, getting straight to the plate is helping take some stress off his arm, as well as getting rid of that Vulcan change, taking some stress off the arm.
That makes sense. So, obviously, pitching has been one of the, if not the main strength for the Chinook so far this season. And, obviously, you guys are riding first-place record right now, largely on the back of the pitching staff. Certainly must be a point of pride for you. But what has been the focus for the staff during this year so far that has made them so successful?
Definitely getting ahead of batters. A lot of first pitch strikes and a lot of leadoff outs. We've done a great job of not allowing the leadoff runner to get on base. And when you're able to start an inning basically with one out, it makes it a lot harder to score. And our pitchers have done a great job of getting that first guy out. And then we found ourselves in some tough spots and just finding ways out. And our guys right now aren't afraid to pitch to contact. We have the most innings pitched in the league, and I think we're like second to last in strikeouts, but we're not walking a whole bunch of guys. And that's something I've tried to tell these guys. None of our guys are really overpowering, with the exception of Leo. Argo's got some heat, and Reese, but everyone else, I mean, they got to be contact pitchers. And once they realize that, you know, they're going to be good pitchers for the rest of their careers. You got defense like Pate behind you to do things like that, you know?
And my goodness, that would have been an amazing double play, but unfortunately they're going to have to settle for just an amazing play in general. But a great play there, certainly, obviously, as we were just talking about, the great defense by Pate Fullerton there.
Yeah, the defense, we're top in defense right now. Our fielding percentage is amazing. Our middle guys have done tremendous. You know, John Mark, today we got Cal at second, who's a great defender, and when Paddy's at second, I mean, you don't turn a triple play with bad defense. So,
sir, you do not. Certainly. So, yeah, you mentioned a couple of guys there, but I want to focus on Leo and some of the other two-way guys that you have on the team.
Right.
So, what is the mentality for you as a coach? Obviously, every coach's approach is different, but for you in the ABL up here for the Chinooks, what is your mentality as it pertains to those two-way guys that's different from just your normal everyday POs?
I mean, POs right now, obviously we have more of a set routine of guys when they're throwing. Two-way guys, it's got to be a lot more pick and choosy. Like, we wanted to get Hayden Keller an inning last night, but we also wanted to be able to use him as a pinch hitter. And get foul. That a boy.
And a great play there by Colby.
I'll finish this question before I head back, but, you know, two-way guys, we just got to make sure that if they're pitching, that they're not playing the field, and that I got to make sure my communication with Coach Groth is good and make sure that he's not planning on using them in the game or anything like that, so we're able to get those guys the innings they need. So expect to see Hayden Keller get some innings here soon. Leo's going to continue to pitch for us. And, you know, it's a little bit more difficult to make sure that those guys get their innings, but we're going to make sure it gets done.
Awesome. So I assume you do have to get going, unfortunately.
Yep. Hello, so, Manny. Hi. I waved to the computer. You can't see me.
So, Troy, if this is the last interview you end up doing before you head out, I know that you're leaving next week to go back to the job. So I just wanted to say thank you so much for what you've done for these guys. And hopefully, even if you do have to leave, hopefully the stream will give you some love as well.
Awesome.
Is there anything you want to say to them before you head out?
Just appreciate everyone who supported the guys up here. It's been an unreal summer so far, and they're working their tails off. And the guys love coming in here and talking. So anytime a guy comes here, start shooting some comments at him, make him answer questions, and make him blush.
There you go. Thank you so much, Coach.
Yep, thank you.
the Chinooks, a junior first baseman from Gardner Webb, number 8, Joe Brazil.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as Joe Brazil steps up to the plate here and takes strike one. So, again, thank you so much to Coach Troy Hervey for coming in here, albeit for a quick interview. I tried to get as many questions as I could because obviously it's probably going to be his last interview, unfortunately, as he is leaving in the next couple of days, but... again, thank you to him for all that he's done for these guys. Certainly a great guy, very level-headed, and has given these guys a lot of wisdom to take with them far beyond here, both pitching and not pitching, as that play will result in the first out of the inning as a great job there by Michael McNamara to stay with that throw. So Joe Brazil grounds out to third for the first out of the inning, and that will bring up Matt Magno. Matt Magno behind the plate again tonight after getting a well-deserved day of rest yesterday. Had a nice interview with him during yesterday's game. Has certainly had a good time. Would love to get him up here again. And that pitch is in there for a called strike. And again, speaking of interviews, we have a lot more to come for you guys. So certainly going to be a great day for those of you who love interviews. So kind of everybody really wanted to hop in today, and obviously we found out about Mr. Parnell wanting to do an interview very recently, so we already had the three interviews planned for the guys, and then we added another one on, so we have four for you guys today. So I'm working my buns off over here trying to get you guys interviews. And the 0-2 is swung on and drilled to fairly deep center field. Escher going back, and he is not going to get it. So Matt Magno with an absolute bullet to center field, and Cole Escher could not run it down. And so that will be a double for Matt Magno. And certainly one of the toughest balls for an outfielder, ones that you're basically running straight backwards. And I think he might have even been able to get a glove on it, but certainly a tough enough play where that will not be considered an error. And now Cal Campbell will step up, and he has walkout music for, I think, the first time this season. So that's good. I'm glad. And the 0-0 to him is outside. So Cal Campbell getting the start at second base tonight as Paddy McKermitt gets a day of rest, and he will join us in the fourth inning of this ball game, along with Joe Kiel, as Allen's in there for a called strike. So a good day for interviews today, certainly. As for the second inning in a row, the Chinooks have a man in scoring position with less than two outs. So we will see if the Chinooks can capitalize this time, as that one is tapped to first, so at the very least, Cal Campbell able to move Magno over to third. But that will be the second out of the inning as the red-hot Will Batts will step up to the plate. And he has certainly been on a bit of a tear in the last couple of games as he went two for three in yesterday's ball game and had a single already tonight. And he also came in off the bench in the last game and got himself a hit. So he's been swinging the bat well the last few games. And, you know, he'd love to keep that going as that curveball is also upstairs. So two close curveballs for Sikorsky. No dice for either of them as the count moves to 2-0. Certainly beneficial for Batts here as he looks to get the Chinooks on the board in the bottom of the second. And that one is swung on and fouled straight back and out of play.
That foul ball brought to you by Three Bears Alaska.
Sikorsky looking to get out of another jam here on 2-1, and out is a good pitch from Sikorsky as Bats swings and misses. Clearly, he seemed to be looking for something else. So the count moves to 2-2 on Will Bats. And the 2-2 from Sikorsky is swung on and tapped down the first baseline, but foul.
That foul ball brought to you by Edward Jones Financial Advisor.
So certainly the Chinooks doing a good job of making Sikorsky work hard in the first couple of innings. Has not thrown nearly as many pitches in this half inning as he did in his first one, but still, certainly the Chinooks have done a good job of making him throw a lot of pitches. That one is in there for a called strike three. As Will Bats goes down looking to end the inning. So once again, the Chinooks come up empty here in the bottom of the second. So Nelson Schutte will look to continue his hot start early in this one when we head to the top of the third.
First winning red ticket number is ticket 789-3347. Again, winning ticket number 789-337. Take your winning ticket to the Chinook Shack to claim your prize from Tinker's Cafe. Tell me I'm more than just the scars I've known. All that we love is all we off the top of the third for the Glacier Pilots, first baseman number 28, Michael McNamara.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as the first pitch of the inning from Nelson Schutte is up and in to Michael McNamara, who's playing first base today. But more importantly, I am joined by a very, very special guest here as Sean Parnell, the former state representative and governor and current University of Alaska Anchorage chancellor, is joining us here in the studio. So certainly a very special guest. Sir, how are you doing today?
I'm great. It's a beautiful night for a ball game. It's great to be with you, Tyler.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy schedule to be with us, not only here in the booth, but here for the
game on a beautiful Friday night.
Absolutely. Not much better that you could do than watching some baseball on a Friday night. Absolutely. So, obviously, we mentioned you just became the UAA chancellor, so obviously huge congratulations to you. So what started you on that journey, wanting to transition from kind of government to now that position?
You know, I just love UAA's mission, the way that it creates opportunities for people to get their education, get their certificates, change the trajectory of their lives. You know, as we're thinking about this pandemic, it's really got people thinking about what they want to do next. UAA is ready to help them do that.
Absolutely, sir. That makes a lot of sense. So one thing that I know that you're very proud of is the UAA Performance Scholarship. So why don't you take us through kind of the process of developing that and what you think, or what it certainly does do for prospective students at UAA.
Yeah, well, listen, one of the barriers to people thinking they can go get a certificate or get a degree is affordability. They don't think they can afford UAA or another school. But I'm here to tell you that we have ways to make education assistance, financial assistance available. Alaska Performance Scholarships was something we created to make sure that high school students could earn scholarships to use at any Alaska university. They just had to take some rigorous courses, take a little bit extra in terms of credits, and earn those scholarships. So that's one element of financial aid that is available. But I'm just really here with the message of if you want to get some more schooling, we've got financial aid available, and there's more than you might know about.
Certainly. So talk a little bit, if you would, about your time in state and local government. Obviously, the government kind of gets certain raps for common people nowadays. But so is there anything that you learned about the government that has now been able to translate into your time at UAA?
Yeah, you know, government is supposed to be about public service. It's supposed to be about others, you know, focused on the best of the people that you're serving. And as I think about my government service, I always kept in mind how I was going to clear paths of opportunity for people. And now at UAA, I get this great opportunity to just clear paths of opportunity for Alaskans and beyond to the next step in their lives, the next stage of their future. That's what gets me excited. That gets me up every morning, is that opportunity to just clear a path to somebody's future.
Awesome. That's certainly a noble quest. So what got you started in the realm of being a state representative and a governor? Because, you know, a lot of kids, you know, when they're growing up, people ask what they want to do. And a lot of them will say, I want to be the president of the United States. But I don't generally hear a lot of, I want to be a state representative. So what kind of got you started on that path?
You know, you really do have to start somewhere. And I just saw that I had a desire to serve others in the public arena. It's kind of like starting in the minor leagues and then advancing to the pros. You know, you got to learn to walk before you can run. You got to learn to work through, you know, you got to learn your job before you step into the larger arena like being governor. And it's just been an honor to be able to serve. But I am just so excited to be part of UAA and be here with you guys tonight. We're watching some young people play here. They're all going to school. They all went on after high school to continue their education. I'm really here to encourage Alaskans to do that. We've got this next chapter in our state's history where we need Alaskans to step up and you mentioned the political arena and what a mess it is right now. We need good people to step into that arena and to have that heart of service for others. And that's, I think, everything that I'm seeing about the people at UAA, they really have a heart for others. And so when you're a student and you're coming through those doors, you're going to find people that care about you and care about your future.
Well, that's awesome, because certainly a lot of kids, when they go to college, sometimes they may not necessarily find that, especially if they go to bigger schools. So what separates, obviously in Alaska, it's a little bit different than it would be in a place like California or in a place like Florida, where there's millions upon millions of people and hundreds upon hundreds, if not thousands, of different universities and colleges. So what separates UAA in your mind to all the other colleges in Alaska and in the nearby area?
Well, first off, we're providing instruction in programs where people can get real jobs in Alaska. And if you want to work in Alaska, we've got an educational path that'll make that happen. But secondly, when you walk through the door, you're going to find people that care about you. I mean, I'm involved right now, along with a whole range of people at UAA who are personally calling up incoming freshmen and continuing students. And I think that's what you're going to find, is that personal touch at UAA.
Awesome. Well, sir, I had a bunch more questions I wanted to ask you, but unfortunately we did run out of time. So, sir, is there anything else that you would like to say to our amazing people on the stream before you head out?
You know, I love Alaska. I love UAA, and I love what that institution does for Alaskans and for people beyond. And I would just encourage you that if you want to take charge of your future, if you want to take a new turn and take a new direction with your future, give us a call at UAA. We'd be happy to talk with you.
All right. Well, thank you so much,
yeah,
sir,
thanks,
for joining
Tyler.
Us. And thank you so much for coming out here and supporting us in all the ways that you do. So thank you very much, sir.
Happy to be here.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as John Mark Mullen stepping up to the plate here against Easton Sikorsky, who has not looked probably at his very best so far, as he has already given up three hits and had plenty of foot traffic on the base path so far. But he has able to work himself out of a couple of jams so far, so certainly he will look to settle in rather quickly and give his team a good amount of innings. And Mullen swings at that pitch and taps it over to Michael McNamara at first base, and that will be the first out of the inning. So certainly I want to say thank you so much to former Governor Sean Parnell for joining us here in the studio and joining the Chinooks here. I had a few more questions I hoped to ask him about how he got started here with the Chinooks and different things of that nature, and also his time actually as a baseball player. I kind of wanted to go into that. But unfortunately, he did not have a lot of time, was only able to stay for a half an inning, and it was a rather quick one. Either way, though, a very, very good interview. Obviously, he's done a few of those before, so certainly he is well-spoken as John Graham taps over to first base, and the flip to Sikorsky is a bit offline, and so John Graham will reach on an error here to get things started for the Chinook. So again, thank you so much to Governor Parnell for joining us here in the studio. Certainly a huge honor to speak to somebody with his kind of credibility and his kind of stature, not only at UAA but in the world. So certainly a big pleasure for me to be able to do that, and certainly has done a great job with what he has done. Absolutely. So with that, Hayden Keller will step up to bat here for the Chinooks, as that one is tapped down the left field line and well out of play. So Hayden Keller singled in his first plate appearance. Kind of a little tap shot over the shortstop's head. So I'm sure he'll look to continue his hot swinging, as that one's in the dirt. And we still have a couple of interviews for you guys today. These ones will be a little bit longer than the last two, at least I do hope, as we have the combination of Paddy McKermitt and Joe Kiel joining us for a dual interview. I know I discussed earlier about me taking the crowd mic, as that one's in the dirt, and John Graham will take off and move up to second base on the wild pitch from Sikorsky, as that one got away from Jones. So once again, for the third straight inning, the Chinooks have a runner in scoring position with less than two outs, and they haven't been able to capitalize up to this point, so let's see if they can at this juncture. So anyways, I know I talked about having myself have the crowd mic and them have the headsets, but I think what might be a little easier is if we give them the crowd mic and have them just kind of stand and share the microphone, and then me just talk into the headset. Although I will ask for your guys' feedback on that if it is a little bit difficult to hear them or anything of that nature, as that one is drilled into deep center. And that's going to get over the head of Escher. So John Graham's going to come around to score, and Hayden Keller's going to turn and head for third. And he is going to get there standing up. And so Hayden Keller continues his hot hitting ways as the Chinooks now lead 1-0 on the one out RBI triple from Hayden Keller. And that will bring up Colby Ferris, as the Chinooks offense certainly having a great start to the day despite only having one run. They have gotten themselves into good spots early on in this ball game against Easton Sikorsky. And Sikorsky's going to have to look to bounce back here, as that one is downstairs and possibly outside for ball one. So Colby Ferris kind of floated one out into shallow center, and Cole Escher made a nice sliding play to rob Colby Ferris of a hit and an RBI, as that one is tapped out to short. And Colby Ferris will ground out to shortstop, but he does his job as Hayden Keller comes across to score. So that will move the score to 2-0 on the RBI ground ball from Colby Ferris. And now Paige Fullerton will step up to the plate. He grounded out to shortstop in his first appearance to end the first inning and strand the bases loaded. So certainly Fullerton will look to bounce back as that one's in there for a called strike. So the Chinooks lead 2-0 here in the bottom of the third inning as they've scored two in this one. Or I should say in this half an inning. And the 1-1 to Fullerton is just downstairs. Tough pitch to take for Fullerton, but he did. And so the count moves to 2-1 with two outs here in the bottom of the third. And the 2-1 is also downstairs. So the Chinooks, in the midst of a pretty decent homestand, or at least the mostly a homestand, as this is the second game of a back-to-back against the Pilots here at Lee Jordan Field, as that one is inside for ball four. So Paige Fullerton draws a two-out walk. And now Joe Brazil will step up to the plate. So anyways, this is the back half of two straight games at home against the Pilots. And then tomorrow, so Saturday, we will have a day off again. So another day of rest for the Chinooks. And then Sunday, we will be right back here at Lee Jordan Field facing the Pilots once again for the third time in 4 days. And then another day off for the Chinooks. So certainly a nice little six-day stretch with three off days. So definitely a welcome sight for the Chinooks. And they have a good amount of days off over the next couple of weeks. And then it gets to be a huge road trip starting on July 9th all the way through the 17th. They do not have a day off. So it will be a rough stretch for them and for all of us here in the broadcast studio, although I will not be with you guys during that time because I actually will be the best man at my best friend's wedding. So I will not be joining you guys on the homestand, but we're trying to work out who will be your broadcaster. It could be Aaron. It could be Casey, our PA here at home might be going on the road trip. So we will see, and I will keep you guys up to date on that as the time gets closer. Just figured I'd throw it out there while it was in my head. But certainly I will continue to remind you guys of that as time goes on. So Joe Brazil did pop out to shortstop in that one. So that will be the third out of the inning. But the Chinooks strike for two. And we will head to the top of the fourth with the Chinooks up 2-0.
Hey there, everybody. This is Paddy.
All right. So sounds like we have a working crowd mic. So hopefully this is good audio for you guys. But We're back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network, and I am joined by two very special guests today, as Paddy McKermitt and Joe Kiel have decided to join us in the studio here for a dueling interview. So it's going to be exciting. Guys, how are you today?
Oh, I'm doing great. It's a great day at Lee Jordan. Get to be here with Joe. I'm just excited to be here.
Oh, yeah. You know, there's really no place I'd rather be than standing in the booth here with Paddy and T. Lopes and Aaron.
Oh, fantastic.
You know, it's
thank
just
you, sir.
It's just a good day. Great day at the yard.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for the kind words. I really appreciate it. So my first question, obviously, Joe, I've interviewed you before, so my first question is going to be for Paddy. Paddy, you are a returner here for the Chinooks. We do not have a lot of returners. So what have you seen from this year's Chinook squad that you may not have seen from previous years that has made this team so successful so far?
Well, when I was here my first year, we all had really good chemistry. It was great guys to be around. And this year, we just really clicked since day one. Like, the guys, we've all been all together, and just we've meshed since day one. And it's been really cool to see how tight-knit we are and just how much fun we're having at the park every day.
Awesome. So a question for both of you guys. So if you had to give a level of 1 to 10, how much fun do you guys have just kind of being in the dugout? Is it a 10? Is it like a 5? Like, where does that number generally sit at on a normal day?
Joe, you want to take that one?
Man, I'll tell you what. If we could go higher than 10, I would.
Hey, man,
because,
whatever.
I mean,
whatever your number is.
You know, everybody loves playing, but when I'm in the dugout, I just try to have fun with it, and I feel like I do. I feel like I help a lot of other guys have fun in there, too, if their spirits aren't so high. So, I don't know. We have a blast in there, really.
Awesome.
Talk a little smack, too. Let the umpire know what it is.
All right. So, again, another question for Paddy. So, you kind of jumped all around in the lineup. You batted leadoff, you batted second, you batted ninth, you batted sixth. Like, it's just kind of been all over the place. So, does your mentality change if you kind of either go from batting very low in the lineup to very high, or very high to very low, or is it just kind of all the same, doesn't really matter?
This is definitely something new for me. I haven't really bounced around the lineup as much as I have until this summer, but my mentality is the same. Still hunting first pitch fastballs, looking for good pitches to hit, and seeing the ball up in the zone, and trying to put good swings on balls. There's a fly ball right there to Will Batts to end the inning, though.
Right, so
great play.
End the inning, but do you guys have time to do another half an inning?
Oh, we'd love to stay and keep you company for the next half inning.
That sounds great. All right. Well, in that case, we're going to have more from these two lovely gentlemen behind me when we come back in the bottom of the fourth. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as we are serenaded by Cindy Lauper. So that can only mean one thing, as Matt Magna will step up to the plate here to lead off the bottom of the fourth. But more importantly, I am still joined here by two fantastic gentlemen in Paddy McKermitt and Joe Kiel have graced us with their presence here in the studio. So again, thank you guys for taking some time out of your day to join us.
So, Joe, I actually have a question for you. So, I've said it a couple of times on some of the streams. You're not your stereotypical power hitter. You bat 3-4 in the lineup normally, but you kind of seem to go the opposite way with a lot of your at bats. Is that just kind of a happenstance so far here in the ABL, or is that a norm for you?
Usually when I'm taking my best swing, I'm living through center field, left center. But I don't know. I've been getting a lot of fastballs away this summer, and I struggled the first 3 or 4 games. I was chopping balls in the ground to shortstop, and then finally I let them get deep, and I've been able to drive some balls that way. Lord willing.
Right.
I struggled last night, but maybe I'll get another shot tomorrow.
Gotcha. So this is going to be a question for both of you guys. So what is your mentality on a day like this where you have a day off? Is it kind of like, is it more like anxious, like you just want to get out there? Is it more supportive? Is it just kind of more, not necessarily indifferent, but just kind of like go with the flow, like, okay, I understand where the coaches are going with this. Like, where do you kind of sit on that scale?
Oh, well, Joe here is the best team guy you could ask for. I mean, in the dugout, just the support he gives is something I'll definitely look up to, and I try to piggyback off that and cheer on our guys. And we both got to stay ready. I mean, the past 2 games, I've been sitting out. I've been coming in late. I got a pinch run and then played some D last time. So I'm going to be ready to head out there if they need me. So just staying locked in and cheering on our team, because being there for the guys is the best thing you can do.
Absolutely. Joe?
Coach Groth playing a little dodgeball down there. No, yeah, for me, on a day off, when I show up, obviously, like, you look at the lineup and you see your name not in there and you're like, oh, okay, well, I guess I get it. I played yesterday, whatever. So, I don't know. I take it as, like, a chance to get to know some guys better in the dugout, cheer some guys on. Just, I don't know, I'm trying to bring as much positive as I can every single day just to – I don't know, maybe I can make somebody's day with something that I say or something that I do or cheering them on, and I don't know, it's just fun. I enjoy it. I mean, obviously I love catching, but I enjoy getting the day off, getting to chill in the dugout.
Absolutely. Is
I that hope he misses that.
Foul, and that will stay in play long enough for Connor McGuire to saunter over and make the catch. So that'll be 2 outs. So running out of time here with you guys. So I will ask another question for both of you. So obviously a few guys ended up coming in late. Some missed a couple days. Some missed a couple of weeks of the season. So has it been difficult trying to acclimate those guys, or for some of them, re-acclimate those guys into the culture and into the team, or has it been very, very simple, or does it come somewhere in the middle?
Yeah, I mean, Hayden and Joe both came in late, and they're both returners, and I was really close with them 2 summers ago, and we haven't lost a beat. And Josh Sheck coming in, great guy, and just unfortunate to see what happened yesterday to him, and just getting that guy, meeting him, and he's just a great guy to talk to, and getting him acclimated to the team. We've meshed really well, like I've said, and no matter when guys are coming in, we've been really close with them.
Gotcha. So that one is in there for a called strike 3. So unfortunately, I don't want to keep you guys too long, as I know that you guys might have to pinch hit or go in for defensive replacements or what have you today. So is there anything that you guys would like to say to the lovely fans on the stream before you head out?
Go Chinooks.
Yeah, go Chinooks. Thanks for watching if you're here on the YouTube channel, and try to get a win for you guys today.
Sounds good. Thank you guys so much for joining us, and we hope to get you back in here soon, all right?
Love you, Mom.
Oh, there you go.
Me too.
All right, thank you guys.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as Nelson Schutte will look to continue his success so far as Connor McGuire, the third baseman, will step up to the plate here in the top of the fifth and a very quick ball game so far in this one. As we are almost halfway through this one, and only an hour or so has passed. So certainly a quick ball game so far, and a lot of that has to do with the efficiency of Nelson Schutte, who has just performed admirably well so far in this one. Certainly a big bounce-back performance from him so far, as I'm sure, as Coach Hervey talked about a little bit earlier, probably... didn't perform as well as he or the team would have liked. And the 3-1 has popped high in the air. Back behind the infield as Cal Campbell will make the catch. As I think Colby Ferris kind of wanted to take that one, but nonetheless, so they avoid a collision. As speaking of collision, I think it's probably a good idea to give you guys at least some kind of update on Josh Scheck and his condition. So for those of you who do not know, Josh Scheck and Pate Fullerton were going after a pop-up yesterday as that one's tapped over to Pate Fullerton, and he will throw on to first for the second out of the inning. So two quick outs once again here for Nelson Schutte. But anyways, Josh Scheck and Pate Fullerton were going after a pop-up in the infield, and there was a little miscommunication, and they collided into each other. Both of them went down. Fullerton looked to take the brunt of it at first, but he eventually got up and was all right to stay in the game. But unfortunately, Josh Scheck did not get up, not at least without help, and he had to be helped off the field. And right now, he has what is believed to be a right knee contusion. And for those of you who do not know what a contusion is, essentially it is a very deep bone bruise. I've had a couple of those myself, specifically my sophomore year. I had one in my hip, my right hip. And let me tell you, it is no fun. I was pretty sure that I broke something because I couldn't even walk. It was a disaster. But Scheck obviously has not been checked out as of yet by a doctor, so he will hopefully be doing that soon. But as of right now, it is a right knee injury, and he is out for the foreseeable future. So just say some prayers for him as you guys go about your days. But Alec Jones is retired for the third out of the inning. And so another good and quick inning for Nelson Schutte as the Chinooks will head to the bottom of the fifth inning, up 2-0. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as John Mark Mullins leads off the bottom of the fifth. And once again, a quick ball game so far. And a lot of that off the back of a fantastic start so far from Nelson Schutte. Schutte can only watch right now as John Mark Mullins looks to get something started for the Chinooks here, as that one is in there for a called strike. So Easton Sikorsky still out there for the Pilots, and he has pitched fairly well in this one. Got himself out of a couple of jams early. Did end up coughing up a couple of runs as that one is in there for a called strike, as John Mark did not enjoy that. But nonetheless, the count moves to 0-2, so he did cough up a couple of runs in the third and pitched a pretty good fourth inning. So certainly a mixed bag for him so far, but he is pitching well enough to stay out there for sure, as that one is tapped down the third baseline and foul. Now, John Mark, one of two players on the Chinooks to start every game so far for them. And he's certainly earned it. He has been one of the best performers, not just on the Chinooks, but in the league so far this year. It certainly has been a pleasure to watch up to this point, as he's done it all with the bat, with the glove, with the speed. So certainly has performed very well so far. And the 0-2 is up and in to John Mark. He's kind of had to turn out of the way. And the count moves to 1-2. And making Sikorsky work a little bit here. And the 1-2 is downstairs. Not a bad pitch from Sikorsky, but a great take from John Mark. So the count moves to an even 2-2. And obviously we want to say thank you so much to Paddy and to Joe for coming on in here and having a fantastic and really fun interview. That one's ripped down the right field line and foul. Never done two interviews at the same time, or interviewed two people at the same time. But it certainly was fun, and obviously I didn't get any I can't hear them or anything like that comments, so certainly it seemed to work well enough at least. So certainly we'll see if we can do that again from now on. And certainly a lot of fun, and those guys obviously have great personalities, and certainly love being here, as that one is tapped to third and going to have to hurry. And a great play there by Connor McGuire, as he kind of had to stay with that one and the plus speed of John Mark. But McGuire makes the play for the first out of the inning, and so John Graham will step up to the plate. He reached on an error in his last at-bat. He's 0-2 so far. And the first pitch to Graham is outside. So the count moves to 1-0. So certainly, again, thank you to Paddy and to Joe for taking some time out of their day and coming up here and having a great time with me, as that one is tapped into right field. But Ethan Mann will move over and make the catch for the second out of the inning. So two down here for Hayden Keller, and he has swung the bat well so far in this one. He's 2-for-2 with a single and an RBI triple in his last at-bat, and also scored in that inning. So has done well up to this point in the ball game. And the first pitch to him is swung on and drilled into center field again, but this time playable for Cole Escher in center, and he will make the catch for the third out of the inning. So a quick inning for the Chinooks as they go down 1-2-3, and we will head to the top of the sixth inning with the Chinooks having a 2-0 lead.
UAA is excited. wanted to welcome you back to campus, let's get back to class. Visit uaa.alaska.edu/apply to apply today. Virginia and Nina River Chinooks would like to thank UAA for sponsoring tonight's game.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as Michael McNamara will step up and face Nelson Schutte, who has pitched very well up to this point. And the first pitch to McNamara is upstairs. But more importantly than that, I am joined by a special guest once again. In the fourth interview few of today, we have Justin Estrada joining us once again in his second interview of the year so far. So one of our frequent customers here. So thank you for joining us. Justin, how are you today?
Doing great. Watching a great ball game. Schutte's out there shoving tonight, so it's awesome
to
watch that.
Certainly doing well as that one swung on and missed. So, Justin, what have you seen from Nelson specifically as he's gone on this year? Obviously, he's one of the guys that showed up a little bit late in the season, and I think pretty much everybody knows at this point. His first start was a bit rough as he kind of jumped right off the plane and jumped right on the mound. So what have you seen from him as the season has gone on?
Yeah, he's just been pounding the zone like I think a lot of our staff has been doing and just trusting our defense, and they've been making plays out there for him, and he's not walking a lot of guys. He's just pounding the strike zone, letting them get themselves out as he walks somebody, unfortunately. But he's going to get double play ball right here. I'm calling it. So, yeah, he just gets a lot of balls in play, and our defense is great. So he's able to get a lot of guys out that way.
Absolutely. So we had pitching coach Hervey here in the studio earlier. Just talking to him, obviously he's got a lot of wisdom and he's got a lot of knowledge that he passes on to you guys. What have you learned from him so far this year that you really think could stick with you as because obviously he's going to be leaving in the next few days. So what have you learned from him that might stick?
There's been a couple of things that have stuck with me, but the main thing would be we've been talking a lot about changeup grips, and because changeups are very much of a feel pitch, so we've been talking about different grips, pressures, how deep we hold it in our hands, just anything you can talk about with the changeup. We pretty much discussed it this summer already, because I know his time's cut a little short here, so I'm just trying to pick everything out of his head that I can in the month of him being here. So been playing with the changeup a lot with him, and even this before the game today, we were talking about as we come set, what our pressure's like. So we're a lot more weight is on the back foot, your right foot, your drive foot, as opposed to your front foot, so you're able to be more explosive with it. So we were just talking about how you can vary that when you're slide stepping, you want a little bit more.
And he is in there. And my goodness, and you could hear the Chinook dugout going kind of crazy right now, as that was a close play. But Michael McNamara able to swipe second base, and I couldn't tell if that was a strike or not, by the way. Wow, a lot of passion going on in the dugout right now.
Wow. So yeah, we've been talking about a lot of different things, but the changeup's been the biggest thing with him, and even today I was able to get some more information out of him, which I was grateful for that.
Awesome. So going into yesterday's start, you had the lowest ERA among qualified starters in the entirety of the ABL. Again, I don't know exactly where you sit on that, although you only did give up one earned run in that one, so it didn't affect it too much. But what has been working for you specifically so far this year that you think might be the key to your success so far?
So I've gotten my fair share of base runners, unfortunately, due to some walks, but I've been able to wiggle out of it a lot. So I think part of the reason in that is because in my junior college, I came out of the bullpen, so they'd always stick me in situations where there was already runners on, even though they weren't my runners. So just being able to be comfortable in those situations, be comfortable in the uncomfortable situations when runners are on and there's not a lot of outs on the board. So just being able to trust myself and say, I'm going to be able to, my stuff's better than this guy, and know I'm going to be able to get them out and trust my stuff. And absolutely, if I need to pitch to a strikeout, pitch to a strikeout. If I need to pitch the double play ball, try to do that and just trust my abilities out there.
Awesome. So I'm going to ask you, this is a little bit of a different question. Obviously, we've interviewed you before, so a lot of the material that I kind of go through has already been used up for you. So going a little bit of a different direction here, what's it been like for you? Because a lot of people on the stream may not know this, but the Chinooks, after every home game, they stand around, stand by the dugout, and they actually have fans come around, and they sign autographs. Obviously, it's a very, very amazing experience for the fans. But what does an experience like that do for you as just a college athlete, you know, a young man who's just trying to find his way, and being able to have an amazing experience of these little kids coming up and or families of little kids or whatever, what have you, coming up and wanting your autograph? What does that do for you?
Yeah, it's really humbling. It's really cool. As a little kid, you always look up to the people above you, whether it be just the next league above you or the collegiate players. Even when you're in high school, you think the collegiate players are so much above you, even though they might not really be. But it's really cool just to be able to talk to the little leaguers. A lot of them play little league, so we talk to them and say, well, like, oh, what position do you play, or how's your season going, and just talk to them and just try to be there for them as much as they can. If they have questions for you, then answer them and just sign their autographs. It's really, I always joke with my family, oh yeah, the game is over, my wrist is starting to get tired from signing all those autographs. So that's a little inside joke with my family. But
there you go.
Yeah, it's a really cool experience, especially going from no fans in college to jumping up to all these fans and now little kids wanting your autograph. It's really awesome to experience that.
Definitely. So what has there been any kind of silly story that has happened with an instance of signing a little kid's autograph? Have they ever kind of come up to you and wanted you to sign like a strange object, or, you know, kind of giving you a little too much information that you might not have asked for? Has anything like that happened to you so far?
The funniest story would probably be Joe Kiel has gone around asking for people to sign his chest. That's probably the funniest story that I got. It wasn't even a kid. It was Joe Kiel or catcher. So.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah, that was certainly a little strange.
Certainly a big personality. We just had Joe in here. Man, I could interview that guy for hours. He's hilarious. You never really know what he's gonna come up with. But that makes a lot of sense. We'll put it that way. So, not even a little kid doing that. Just Joe. Unbelievable. Yep. So, speaking of Joe, what has your relationship been with him on the mound as it compares to off the field? Is there really any difference? Do you kind of see a more, is there a more serious side of Joe when he's behind the plate, or is he kind of the same?
He's a little bit more serious when he's in game, but he still knows when to have fun. Like in the dugout, he'll be having more fun as opposed to when he's out there actually catching. But I have the opportunity where Joe's on my van, so I get to experience a lot of Joe, to say the least. So he's always the guy that's playing the music in the van, and I get to experience some rural country, as he says, because California country is not the same. No Florida Georgia Line in that van. Right. He's playing some rural country songs in there, and some of them I don't even know. They're just about tractors and trucks, and I don't know. Some of them are pretty good, though. I've added a couple to my playlist, so he's put me on a couple songs.
That's good.
But yeah, him and John Mark, they're like an old couple that likes to argue a lot of the times. So it's sometimes I just sit back and just watch them. It's like watching TV sometimes.
Oh man, that's awesome.
Yeah, he's funny.
So I suppose I already know the answer to this, but if you could have a Chinook sitcom, who do you think would be the star of that show? Do you think it'd be Joe?
Oh, 100%. 100%. It would be Joe. Joe, and then his wife would be John Mark.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, they felt like a couple. They really do.
Awesome. So Speaking of sitcoms, do you have kind of like a favorite kind of wind down show where, you know, you have a day off, you don't really feel like going out necessarily, so I'm just going to kind of sit around, lounge around, grab some snacks and watch something. Do you have a particular thing that you like to watch in that scenario?
Usually I don't really watch too much TV, but while I've been out here, my roommate, Brendan Argo, we've been watching, well, we've watched three episodes of iCarly together.
iCarly.
Because it just came out, so we're actually planning on watching three more episodes tonight, so.
Didn't they just release, like, a new iCarly,
yeah, that's
right?
What we've been watching.
Oh, okay. Is it any good so far, or is it kind of strange after the first show?
Some of the comedy's a little out there, but it's all right. It's good. I'd give it a B+.
Well, how old is Spencer now? He must be in his 40s at this point. I mean, I kind of remember when I was a kid, he looked like he was like 23. Now he must be probably in his 40s now.
Yeah, he's probably upper 30s, 40-ish, uh-huh. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, those characters are older now.
Well, I'll have to check that out. So I do want to let you know this before, and let the fans know this before it happens, but I think that we're going to try and do the first fan Q&A of the season for you, Justin, just to kind of change things up a little bit. So obviously I know you wanted to stick around for another half an inning. So what we're going to do, so all you fans that are only half listening on the stream because we've been doing an interview right now, listen up here, because in the next half an inning, or maybe even right now if you have them, but I probably won't get to them until the next half inning, if you have any questions for Justin that I have not covered or that I have covered and you kind of want to go a little more in-depth, put that in the comment section below, and we will get to that in the bottom half of the inning. It might only be one or two, Justin. I'm not sure how this will go. It's the first time I'm doing it, so you're probably going to be our guinea pig here.
Right.
So I do apologize for that, but we're going to see how that goes. So I did want to give you that warning as Blake Wink will steal second base, and the count moves full to Devin Lopez. So after kind of breezing through the first five innings, and Shooty is having a little bit of trouble here in the top of the sixth. So, Justin, is there anything that you're seeing from him right now that's kind of that you think might be causing the issue, or –
He's just losing the zone a little bit. If he comes back right here with the strike. Oh, there we go.
And a huge strikeout as Magno fires on to first, and Joe Brazil does a good job of keeping his foot on the bag as Devin Lopez strikes out. And just like Justin said, a huge strikeout for Shooty there as he has a good chance to get out of this inning with no damage done. But it's going to be a tough task as Nick Hagedorn will step up to the plate. Has not had a particularly great ball game so far as he's 0-for-2, but yesterday went 2-for-2 with two walks. So had a good ball game yesterday. But Shooty has certainly kept not just him, but pretty much everybody off balance so far today in this one. So the first pitch to him is a curveball just up. Didn't quite have that last second snap he was looking for. So the count moves to 1-0. So, obviously, we talked a little bit last time, for those of you that might not remember, about kind of what you do on your days off and going to, you know, explore, go hiking, fishing, what have you, as that one is flown out to center field, and Shooty will get out of this with no damage as Will Bats will put that one away for the third out of the inning. So we'll have to get to that question in the bottom half of in the bottom half of the inning, but again, fans, put your questions in the comments section that you have, because if you don't have any, then this might get real awkward. So please make sure you do that. We will be right back with Justin Estrada as we head to the bottom of the sixth.
baseball league score update. In the top of the seventh inning, the Anchorage Bucks beat the Peninsula Oilers 3-1. Leading off the bottom of the sixth for the Chinooks, a redshirt freshman right fielder from Tarleton State, number 25, Colby Ferris.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube, and I am joined here by Justin Estrada, and I'm still waiting on if any of you fans out there have any questions for him in this half an inning. I'm leaving it wide open. I only have one or two more questions left in my brain. I have done a lot of interviews today, so please help. No, I'm kidding. But, obviously, Justin, again, thank you so much for taking time to come here and join us as Colby Ferris smacks that one into right field for a base hit. So Colby Ferris starts this inning off with a bang with his first hit of the ball game. And so the Chinooks once again have the leadoff man on. And Paige Fullerton will step up to the plate. So anyways, Justin, the question that I was going to ask you, obviously we've talked about what you kind of your mentality is on off days. But that kind of was in the context of, you know, having one off day a week, basically. But in this stretch, you know, you're going to have 3 to 5 off days in a very short and condensed period of time. So does your mentality in terms of that change at all as Fullerton? Oh, he just gets out there. Almost beat that one out. That would have been a fantastic play for him. But he does at least move the runner over. So anyways, does your mentality kind of change when you have that many days off in such a short and condensed period, or are you still kind of seeking all of those days to kind of go out and do something?
So from the perspective of a player, it's sort of, as a starter especially, it sort of messes up the routine a little bit, because I was used to having 5 days in between starts, so it was rocking like the pro schedule, but it's a little different now. So now we're going back to a college schedule where I have 6 or 7 days in between, so I mean, I'm going to be more fresh, but at the same time, so for the baseball perspective, I sort of like the 5 days, but also I'm going to be more fresh. So, I mean, I'm sort of torn between the two, but from being able to go explore Alaska, I love the more off days, the more I get to do, the way I look at it. I don't sit at the house on off days. I'm always asking the guys, oh, what are you doing? And just trying to figure out what everyone's doing and then trying to tag along somewhere, create some plans myself and get them to tag along with me. So I think I have some plans set up tomorrow with Nate, but just got to make sure that he's still on board.
Big unit, Nate Hemrick. Oh.
Yep, big Nate.
Certainly a good time, probably. I don't know what you guys will be doing, but I'm sure it'll be fun. excuse me, as Joe Brazil's falling down 0-2, and he flies that one out to right field, and he will move over to make the catch. Well, Ethan Mann and Colby Ferris will tag up and head over to third. So at the very least, a productive out for Joe Brazil there as he's able to move the runner over to third. As now Matt Magno will step up to the plate with an RBI chance here. And another one of another catcher for you there, Justin. So what has been the biggest difference? Because I do believe that you've had both Joe and Matt catch you in separate starts. So what's the biggest difference, you think, between the two of them in terms of their catching styles?
Yeah, so I think I've had Matt for almost all my appearances except for one. My latest start was actually Joe back there.
Gotcha.
So I feel like their catching styles are pretty similar. It's a pretty smooth transition when I went to Joe this last start. It was sort of funny. The only reason we went to Joe was not that I'm against Joe catching me. It was because the rotation got messed up a little bit when Ogro had gone under the weather. So it had messed up our – we'd always be with the same catcher, it seemed like. But then it got mixed up a little bit. But, yeah, I feel like they're pretty similar. I haven't noticed any really big differences between the two.
All right. Well, unfortunately, Justin, I guess the fans didn't have any questions for you, but we were able to get through it. So is there anything you'd like to say to them before you head out, buddy?
Yeah, I just want to say hi to my family at home, my parents and my siblings and all my aunts and uncles and my cousin and Samantha back at home. So I just want to say hi to them, and I miss you guys.
All right, man. Well, thank you so much for joining us, and we'll look to get you back in here again, all right?
Yeah, awesome. Thanks all for right, having me.
No problem.
members, the Weller Booster Club members, take out their white tickets now. Our first of two winning white ticket numbers is ticket 545-9540. Our first winning white ticket number is ticket 545-9540. Take your ticket to the Chinook Shack to claim your prize from Signature Hair Salon. Our second winning white ticket number is ticket 545-9546. Our second winning white ticket number is ticket 545-9546. Take your white ticket to the Chinook Shack to claim your prize from Central Perth. If you have any questions or would like to become a Chinooks Booster Club member, ask for Danielle in the team tent. Leading off the top of the seventh for the Glacier Pilots, right fielder number 5.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as Ethan Mann steps up to the plate to lead things off against Nelson Schutte, who has pitched phenomenally well so far in this one. Got out of a bases-loaded jam in the last inning, and a huge inning for the Chinooks, as clearly in a game this tight, every run matters. And that pitch is tapped on to Paige Fullerton at third, and the throw on to first for the first out of the inning. Well, once again, thank you so much to Justin Estrada for joining us here in the booth today. Obviously not his first go-round in the booth so far this year, and it's a little easier for guys like him to come in here, as obviously he's a starter, so he knows when he's not playing. But certainly appreciate him coming in here nonetheless, and we'll probably see him in here once again, as that one is flown out to Will Batts in center field for the second out of the inning. And shaping up to be another quick one for Schutte, as I'm sure he'll love that after a bit of a lengthy top of the sixth for him. As Cole Escher will step up to the plate, he's made some good plays out in center field today. But at the plate, much like most of the Pilots lineup, has not had a fantastic day so far, as he's 0-2. That pitch is just downstairs for a ball. And my goodness, what a game so far from Nelson Schutte. Certainly a big bounce-back performance from him after a rough outing last time. And the adjustments that Coach Hervey talked about when he was in here early on in the game have certainly paid dividends, as he has looked almost like a completely different pitcher out there so far. And the 2-1 is just upstairs, and you can see Schutte wanted that. Didn't get it, and the count moves to 3-1. So a good hitter's count for Escher, as he'll look to do some damage here and get something going with two outs. And the 3-1 to him is downstairs. And I think even Escher thought that was a strike. But he did not get the strike call that he was looking for. Or at least not, maybe not that he was looking for, but that he expected. So that'll be a two-out walk for Cole Escher. So he gets on with two outs as Alec Jones will step up to the plate here. Alec Jones was a designated hitter in last night's ball game, although he struggled, as he has struggled tonight, and he's 0-4. And that one is flown out to right field, and that's going to drop for a base hit. And I didn't want to say it, but that is the first hit of the ball game for the Pilots, as Schutte had no hit them up to that point in the ball game, and that is such an unfortunate way to end that, as just a little bloop single over the second baseman's head. And so that will be the first hit of the ball game. So that is over, but still nonetheless a fantastic game so far for Nelson Schutte, as he still has a good shot at getting out of this one with no damage done. And it's got to be frustrating, though, as If he had gotten out of this inning, I'm not going to lie, guys, I would have probably said something like the countdown is on, but I wouldn't have specified anything. But I didn't have to. So certainly no one can blame me for that, as that one's flown out to shallow center, and Will Batts will come on and make the catch for the third out of the inning. So the no-hitter is indeed finished. However, Nelson Schutte still pitching absolutely fantastic so far in this one, as he has held the Pilots to just one hit in this one, as we will head to the bottom of the seventh inning with the Chinooks up 2-0.
Chinooks. If they don't win, it's a shame. For it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out of the old ball game.
With his second performance of the summer, let's hear it for Chinooks pitcher Carson Cody.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as Cal Campbell will step up to the plate, here in the bottom of the seventh, as the Chinooks will look to add to their lead here as they lead 2-0, but Easton Sikorsky has pitched phenomenally so far. Did not look like he had his best stuff early on, but since giving up 2 runs in the third, he has pitched phenomenally for the Pilots. And has certainly kept his team well in the ball game. As I'm sure if he can make it through this one, he can go back and feel very well about how he pitched today, even if his team may or may not come away with this one, as Nelson Schutte for the Chinooks has pitched even better tonight than I'm sure his team could have possibly asked for, as he no-hit the Pilots for 6 2/3. So Pilots have one hit as we stand here right now, as that one is inside. So the count moves to 3-1. So Schutte has certainly done an amazing job so far tonight, and it has been a pleasure to watch for sure. So Cal Campbell will look to keep things going, as that one's ripped down the third base line, but just foul. So the count will move to 3-2. So good at bat so far for Campbell. As he's 0-2 so far today, but certainly due. And the 3-2 pitch to him is in there for a called strike 3. And certainly Cal did not like that one, but strike 3 nonetheless. So that will be the first out of the inning, as Will Batts will step up to the plate. And Will Batts coming in. Swinging a hot bat coming into this one. He's 1-for-3 tonight with 2 Ks. So the first pitch to him is swung on and missed. Good change up there from Sikorsky, or at least that's what it looked like from this angle. So a good 0-1 pitch, or a good 0-0 pitch, excuse me, from him there. And now the 0-1 pitch is outside. So count moves to 1-1. As Will Batts will look to get something going for the Chinooks. And that one's upstairs. So At the very least, the first two batters for the Chinooks making Sikorsky work here late in this ball game, and that could really make a difference, as I know that the Chinooks feel that if they can get Sikorsky out of this ball game, they'll have a good chance, and that one's in there for a called strike, and Will Batts shaking his head. And the umpire talking to somebody over there in the dugout. Looks like she's talking to Coach Beck, but I'm not exactly sure if he said something. He's claiming he didn't say anything. And the 2-2 is downstairs. So certainly a bit of a volatile situation so far between the Chinooks and home plate umpire. So we'll have to monitor that as we go along. However, the count again moves full, so two straight full counts to open this inning for Sikorsky. And that one is inside. So the count moving full, and then a ball four for Will Batts. So certainly a great at-bat for him there as he works himself on base, and with his speed, the Chinooks will certainly take it. And now John Mark Mullins, I do apologize, will step up to the plate here, and he will look for his first hit of the ball game as he's 0 for 2 with a walk. And a move over to first, and Batts gets back safely. So again, Sikorsky has pitched very well in this one. Has certainly done more than enough to keep his team in the ballgame. Has only allowed 5 hits from the Chinooks in this one. And the first pitch tomorrow, never mind, as another move over to first. And Batts again gets back safely. So once again, for those of you who are just joining us or didn't hear the announcement early on in the broadcast, this is the second game of a 3-game homestand against the Pilots. However, there is a day off tomorrow, so the 3-game homestand will conclude Sunday afternoon at 2 p.m., That will be the next time the Chinooks will play after today. So the Chinooks will probably have a good day off tomorrow, as certainly they will enjoy this stretch where they have a good amount of days off. Because, again, starting July 9th, they have, I believe, 9 straight road games. So that one's in there for a called strike. So certainly the Chinooks will take the off days when they can get them. Especially then, they will wish that they had home games. Probably by day 4 or 5, they're gonna be praying for a day off. But unfortunately, they won't get one. So certainly they'll enjoy that while they have it. And another move over to first, as Sikorsky really, really wanting to make sure that Will Batts isn't going anywhere, and I can't blame him, as Batts certainly has shown off his speed so far this year, and at this juncture in the ball game, every run counts, every run matters. So even if the Chinooks can manufacture one more run, I'm sure they'll feel a lot better about their chances in this one, as that one's downstairs, and Batts takes off, and he is in there! Close play at the bag, but Batts just sneaks his hand in there, so a stolen base for Will Batts. And for Sikorsky, you have to feel kind of crummy. All that work trying to keep Batts over there at first. And he steals second anyway. So the Cal moves to 2-1 on a pretty good throw from Alec Jones. But unfortunately, Batts just a little bit too fast. Got his hand in there. So the count moves to 2-1 on John Mark Mullins. And so at the very least now, he'll look to move that runner over to third. And set the table for Johnny Graham, as that one's popped down the left field line and playable, but it will land foul, untouched. So John Mark, the third batter in this inning to really make Sikorsky work here. And at this point, you have to wonder if that clock's starting to run out for Sikorsky. And he takes a couple peeks at second, and the 2-2. Swung on and missed. And a good pitch from John Mark as he nods to Sikorsky, proclaiming, yep, that was a great pitch. He got me there. And oh, and it looks like the pitching coach is going to come out and talk to Sikorsky. You can see Sikorsky jumping up and down there, not wanting to come out of the game. But it appears that he will stay in it, as he feels pretty confident that he can get out of this jam. So John Mark Mullen strikes out swinging, and that is the second out of the inning. And now John Graham will have a chance to get another run home for the Chinooks. And the pitcher and catcher having a little chat with the umpire here. Not sure about what exactly, but they are chatting for sure. That I do know. I do know that their mouths are moving, and they are nodding in agreement. That's all I know. So we'll see how this at bat goes as John Graham steps up to in a big spot for the Chinooks, as they would love an extra insurance run going into the top of the eighth. And that one is ripped down the third base line, but it is foul. So strike one on John Graham, and Sikorsky looking to get out of another jam, as he's done pretty much all night tonight, although it hasn't really been, it's been a little while since he's had to get out of a jam, as the last few innings have been pretty good for him. And you know, John Mark would love to get something into the outfield here. And the 0-1 to him is swung on and driven out to center field, but playable for Escher, who will make the catch for the third out of the inning. So nothing comes of the one-out walk to Will Batts, as the Chinooks come up empty here in the bottom of the seventh. But we will head to the top of the eighth with the Chinooks leading 2-0. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube, as the first pitch in there to Grant Wise is in there for a strike, as a new pitcher for the Chinooks, JoJo Penberthy, takes over for Nelson Schutte, who you pretty much couldn't ask for anything else from him today. He held the Pilots to one hit in this one, so certainly if we were to give out an MVP, if the Chinooks were able to pull this one out, certainly Nelson Schutte will get that. As a jam shot, as the bat kind of breaks there, so Grant Weiss will have to get himself a new piece of lumber. So the count remains 0-2, and I'll tell you what, JoJo certainly has been great this year at getting bats to shatter. He's had that a few times. So the count remains 0-2. On Grant Wise. Wise is 0-2, or excuse me, 0-1 in this one. He struck out and hit a sacrifice bunt in his second at bat. So he will look to get something rolling here, as the Pilots are beginning to run out of chances. And the 0-2 is swung on and tapped to Pate Fullerton at third, who moves over and makes the catch, and I don't know what the call's going to be. And he's safe. Oh, my goodness. And you could pretty much, you can really start to hear the Chinooks dugout is really starting to not have it here with some of the calls that have been going on in this game. And again, from our perspective, we can't tell if he's out, if they're out or safe or balls or strikes. It's really difficult, but clearly the Chinooks are having a tough time here trying to figure this out. So unfortunately, that will be a throwing error on Paige Fullerton. So either way, no matter how you feel about it or what's happening here, that will be an error as a pinch runner will step in as Fausto Lopez will take over on the base paths for Grant Weiss. And we'll see if he remains in for the rest of this game, although he would just be a designated hitter. And a move over to first, and Lopez gets back safely. So the Pilots have the leadoff runner on for only the third time in this ball game. So certainly been a rarity as Wink tries to get down a bunt, and he misses. So that'll be 0-1. And a throw over to first as Lopez gets back safely. And another move over to first. And they really feel like they can get him. And it's getting closer every time, but Lopez gets back safely that time. And the 0-1 is swung on and fouled straight back. And Penberthy again gets up 0-2 here. So the count moves to 0-2 on Blake Wink, who is 0-2 with a walk and a stolen base. And the 0-2 is tapped again to Fullerton. He's not going to fire on to second as he was coming in anyway, so he will just throw on to first. And probably a good play there, as that would have certainly been a tough turn and a tough throw for him to make for the speedy Lopez. So didn't want to risk a throw away, a smart, safe play. So Wink is retired for the first out of the inning, but Fausto Lopez will advance to second. And another Lopez, Devin Lopez, will swing for the Pilots with one out and a runner in scoring position. And the first pitch to him is upstairs for ball one. Penberthy looking like he's filling up the zone so far, as I do believe that was the first ball he's thrown in this inning. Not a bad start. And the 1-0, excuse me, is in there for a called strike. So the count moves to 1-1. Penberthy definitely has been the main late inning guy, at least as of late, for the Chinooks. So we'll see if they ride him for the rest of this one, as that one swung on and missed. So good pitch from Penberthy as the count moves to 1-2. And you know the Chinooks and Penberthy himself would love a strikeout here. And the 1-2 is just off the plate. Not a bad pitch from Penberthy, but the count moves to 2-2. And again, as we've talked about with JoJo and without JoJo on the stream, certainly has a lot of Adam Ottavino in him. And that one is just outside for ball three. So the count moves full. Good at-bat from Lopez, making Penberthy work a little bit here. And we'll see if Lopez runs here with a full count, although there's nobody on first, so not sure if it would be the best idea, but that pitch is fouled straight back.
Jeff
another 3-2 from Penberthy is a curveball as that one swung on and ripped into right field, and I think Kobe Ferris dropped it. And he's going to fire on to third. And everybody is safe. So, unfortunately, another error for the Chinooks. And for Penberthy, you got to be sitting there thinking, man, I really should be out of this inning by now. But unfortunately, that is not the case, as now the Pilots have a great opportunity here with two on and just one out. To, at the very least, get one of these runs home and cut the lead in half. As this will bring out pitching coach Hervey, as I'm sure he's talking about what's going on here with the defense. Two errors so far in this inning as have put the Pilots on the brink of getting right back in this ball game and getting all the momentum. So Penberthy looking to work his way out of another jam. He has certainly done an amazing job at that so far this year, and he's going to try and pull another rabbit out of his hat here. Work some magic and get his way out of this as Nick Hagedorn will step up and takes the first pitch downstairs for a ball. And a move over to first, and that one's in the dirt. Good pick from Brazil. As if he didn't pick that, that might have been disaster, but he's able to snag it. And Penberthy's 1-0 as swung on. Fouled off down the left field line. So the count moves to 1-1. And the 1-1 as Lopez takes off, but that one is fouled off, so he'll have to scramble back. So for those of you fans of baseball other than the Chinooks, Fernando Tatis says, hit three home runs already tonight. As that one is swung on and hit foul down the left field line, and that will land foul and untouched. So the count remains 1-2. So JoJo Penberthy up 1-2 here on Nick Hagedorn, looking to get out of danger as he throws over to first, and Lopez gets back safely. And Penberthy's 1-2 is upstairs for ball two. So Hagedorn, good take there. Count moves to 2-2. Can Penberthy get the ground ball he's looking for? Could be the ticket to get him out of the inning. Or at the very least, maybe get a strikeout here. And his 2-2 outside. So the count moves full. As honestly, you know, I've been in scenarios where, you know, you're pitching, you're out there, you're in a big relief spot, close game, and you feel like your fielders are letting you down. You wonder if JoJo's kind of hunting for the strikeout, trying to be a little too fine here. And the 3-2 is swung on and missed. And that one's going to get into center field, so A good move from Lopez to take off on that 3-2 count, but it does look like he's hurt, so that run will score. As Mullins could not dig it out of the dirt, so... So the run will advance on the third error of this inning. As the coach will come out and check on his player, but Lopez appears to be all right. So a stolen base for Devin Lopez and a run scored for Fausto Lopez. As now Ethan Mann will step up with two outs. A runner in scoring position, and never mind, as they will intentionally walk Ethan Mann. So now with two on and two outs, Connor McGuire will step up to the plate. He is 0-3 so far tonight. And for Penberthy, you know, you're sitting there thinking, man, three errors in this inning. And he still has a chance to get out of this with no more damage done, and the Chinooks still with the lead. And that pitch is outside, but still frustrating. And again, I've been in those spots, and you have to wonder if at this point he's starting to get a little too fine, trying to hunt for the strikeout. He did get it, though, in that last at-bat, so it worked out for him. So Hagedorn goes down swinging. Ethan Mann intentionally walked, and now... Connor McGuire is going to step up, and that one is upstairs. Not a bad pitch from JoJo there, but just a little bit high. So the count moves to 2-0. Good count for McGuire. And he wouldn't be in the five hole if he didn't have a little pop in that bat. So we'll see if he's going to be headhunting for a fastball here. And he is, but he swings and misses. So the count moves to 2-1. And that one is also in there for a called strike. So JoJo comes back, evens up the count to 2-2, and a big spot here. And that pretty much goes without saying, but I'm just going to say it anyway, as this is a huge moment for both the Pilots and the Chinooks. If the Pilots can capitalize here and put themselves right back in this ball game. And the 2-2 is swung on and tapped foul as McGuire stays alive. So the count remains at 2-2. Can Penberthy get the pitch to get himself out of this? And that one's tapped. Fullerton makes the play, throws on to first for the third out of the inning. So the Chinooks able to get out of it, but they did have to forfeit a run on three errors in that inning. So a rough inning for the Chinook defense. But luckily, they are able to escape, still with the lead, as we will head to the bottom of the eighth with the Chinooks holding on to a slim 2-1 lead.
Fans, your attention, please. Now pitching for the Glacier Pilots, a 6-foot junior right-hander out of Old Dominion, number 19, Joey Rodriguez. This time, if you will take out your blue Split the Pot tickets, we have the winning ticket number. The Split the Pot tickets. ticket tonight is ticket 617-367. Winning split the pot ticket, 617-367. Take your ticket behind the press box. Our pot tonight sits at $219.50. For the Chinooks, the senior designated hitter from Northwest Azurie, number 12.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as Hayden Keller will step up to the plate. And Mr. Ryan, as it pertains to your questions, so this past season, Fernando Tatis signed a 10-year, $330 million extension for the Pirates, or not the Pirates, the Padres, excuse me. And so that means he's making about $33 million a year, and I would say that he's pretty projected to hit about 50 home runs this year. So I would say he's making about, oh, let's say $670K per home run. That's probably about accurate. So those three home runs he hit today, they probably, it's about $2 million. So those are about $2 million worth of home runs right there for Tatis. That one's in there for a called strike as Hayden Keller grounded out to start the inning. All right, so the count moves to 2-1 here. And Colby Ferris takes that one for strike two as a new pitcher for the Pilots, Joey Rodriguez, comes in. And certainly for the Pilots, Easton Sikorsky pitched plenty well enough in this one, keeping his team in it. As now they only trail by one, as that one is well outside. So the count moves full to Colby Ferris. And actually, I might have been wrong on my math there, Mr. Ryan. As now thinking back, I think I might be getting his and Manny Machado's contract a little bit confused. It might have even been a 15-year contract that he signed. I can't exactly remember, but either way, Colby Ferris swings and misses at that one for the second out of the inning. So two quick outs for Rodriguez in this one. And I did, okay, so I got the number right. I got $330 million right, but I did get the years wrong. It was 14 years. So 14 years. I don't really feel like doing that math in my head. But it's somewhere probably around making about $28 million a year, something like that. So you can do the math in your own head. Either way, it's a lot of money. That's the point. you know, about $1.5 million worth of homers either way. So as Paige Fullerton swings at the first pitch of the at-bat and slaps a single into left field. So Joe Brazil will step up to the plate. He's 0-3 tonight. Hit a big home run a few nights ago, but has pretty mightily struggled from the plate since then. So certainly feeling like he's due to drive one here. And that one is swung at hard, but missed. So the count moves to 0-1. So certainly a big spot for the Chinooks. Would love to get just a little bit of insurance as Reese Lansville warms up in the pen, and it'll be his job. Especially should the Chinooks not get any more runs in this inning, or any runs in this inning, period. It will be his job to shut the door for the Pilots tonight. At least that's what I presume, unless they're going to have JoJo go back out there. And feel bad for JoJo. Certainly went out there, pitched as well as he could. Defense didn't really help him out, but he was able to get out of it, as you could tell by the three errors. They all happened in the last inning for the Chinooks, so definitely a rough inning for them. However, that's in the past, so we'll look forward to seeing what Joe Brazil will do here as that one swung on and missed. So the count moves to 2-2. And the 2-2 is swung on and drilled down the right field line and deep. And moving over is the right fielder, Ethan Mann, to make the catch down the right field line. A well-hit ball for Brazil, but unfortunately does not wind up with anything. So now that will be the third out of the inning. So the Chinooks still lead 2-1, and they will have to work hard if they're going to win this one. As Reese Lansville will step to the mound with the hopes of shutting the door as we head to the bottom, or excuse me, the top of the ninth, with the Chinooks leading 2-1.
Fans, at this time, if you will take out your red tickets, we have our final two red ticket gift giveaways. Our first of two winning red ticket numbers is ticket 789225. First of two winning red tickets is ticket 789225. Second winning red ticket is 789245. Take your ticket to the Chinook Chat and claim your gift from Lucy Daisy. This call to the bullpen is powered by Shop 180. Now pitching for the Chinooks, a 5'10" sophomore right-hander out of the University of Arkansas Little Rock, number 16, Reese Lansville. Leading off the top of the ninth for the Glacier Pilots, center fielder number 16, Paul Escher.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as that first pitch from Reese Lansville is in there for a called strike. So Reese Lansville acting as the stopper tonight for the Chinooks, nursing a one-run lead as that one's upstairs. And certainly if Reese Lansville can lock it down here, he will certainly be able to celebrate tonight as this will not be a easy task as Cole Escher steps up to face Reese Lansville as that one's way outside downstairs for ball two. So after getting ahead, he's quickly fallen behind here, 2-1, as Cole Escher would love to get himself on base, get something going for the Pilots here in the top of the ninth as that one is swung on and drilled towards the gap by Escher. That's going to get down and get to the wall. Escher's going to turn, head for second, and he will stop there. So a leadoff double here for the Pilots, and that's about the last thing you wanted to see if you're the Chinooks. And sometimes that's just what happens when you fall behind, as Cole Escher got into a count where he knew he was getting a fastball and he didn't miss it. And so now the Chinooks are really going to have to work, as this one-run lead is in danger of falling rather quickly here. And a bunt showing there from Alec Jones, but he takes that curveball in there for strike one. So Reese Lansville puts himself in a jam here. Let's see what happens as it pertains to him being able to work himself out of it. And Jones squares around again. This time he gets it down, and Brazil throws on to first for the out. So that will be the first out of the inning, but Alec Jones does his job as he moves the runner over. The tying run is now 90 feet away for the Pilots. So still a chance for Lansville to get out of this. He's going to have to really work for it, as I'm sure the infield will be in Kiel, which, for those of you who don't know baseball speak, that'll just mean the infield is probably going to be on the, well, I guess they're all, it's all turf, but it'll be on the green part of the turf. They'll be playing way in, trying to nab that runner home. And not sure what the conference is happening at home plate, as there appears to be a pinch hitter. I can't exactly see who that is, so we'll get that for you momentarily. And that is Tom Tabak. So Tom Tabak will pinch hit for Michael McNamara, it appears. So Tom Tabak getting the night off today, but he will step in a big spot for the Pilots, and he has been one of their better hitters all year, so certainly a good guy to turn to at this point. So we'll see what Lansville goes with here to attack him. And again, like I said, the infield is in Kiel. They're playing in. And that one is ripped up the middle for a base hit. First pitch swinging. And the game is tied here at two in the top of the ninth. So quickly, the Chinooks squander their lead. But luckily, still a chance here to get out of the inning and go into the bottom of the ninth with a chance to win the ball game. But they're going to have to get through Fausto Lopez first, as he entered the game last inning as a pinch hitter, or excuse me, as a pinch runner, I apologize, and now will take over for Grant Weiss as the designated hitter for the remainder of this ball game, or at least for the foreseeable future in this ball game. And that one is swung on and popped high in the air in foul territory, and Paige Fullerton settles under it to make the catch for out number two. So one out away from being able to go to the bottom of the ninth with a chance to walk it off, but they're going to have to get through Blake Wink first. And Wink is 0 for 3 with a walk and a stolen base so far tonight. So unfortunately for the Chinooks, the first blown save of the season. So certainly kind of speaks to the amazing way the pitchers have, or the relievers have thrown this year so far, as they've been able to slam the door every time they've gotten in the scenario, but not tonight. At least not as of yet. So Lansville is 0-0, is upstairs and inside for ball one. So the 1-0 from Lansville, as I'm sorry, it appears that there's a pinch runner, and I can't exactly tell who that is at first. I apologize for the hesitation, but I was going to say that it was Tom Tabak, but I'm not so sure that it is, actually. And it is not. It is Devin Ornelas has pinch hit pinch ran for Tom Tabak. So I do apologize for that, but Ornelas took off running there, and that pitch is in there for a called strike, too. So one strike away from getting out of this. And got to be frustrating for the Chinooks as three hits for the Pilots, and that has been enough to tie up this ball game so far. So certainly got to be frustrating, but the Chinooks have a good chance to walk it off if they're able to get out of this with no further damage. And a move over to first as Ornelas gets back safely. And another move over to first. And Ornelas gets back safely once again. So Lansville certainly not wanting Ornelas to advance in a scoring position. And I can't blame him at this juncture. But it is one strike away from putting Wink away. And Ornelas running again as Wink fouls that one off.
That foul ball brought to you by Edward Jones financial advisor Gavin Reed.
And another 1-2 is outside. And oh, never mind, not outside, as the umpire rings up Blake Wink for strike three. And Wink's certainly not happy with that, but he gets rung up nonetheless. So the Chinooks, unfortunately, damage has been done. So Pilots get more hits in the top of the ninth than they had all game, and it's enough to tie up this ball game. But the Chinooks have a good chance to walk it off here in the bottom of the ninth, and we will head there. And so we will take a quick break, and we will head to the bottom of the ninth with this game all knotted up at 2-2.
Fans, your attention, please. Now pitching for the Glacier Pilots, a 6'3" freshman left-hander out of Pepperdine, number 11, Hayden Walker.
Everybody get up, it's time to slam now. We got the real jam going down. Welcome to the Space Jam. Here's your chance, do your dance at the Space Jam.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as Matt Magno leads things off for the Chinooks. And unfortunately, damage done in the top of the ninth as the Chinooks went in there with a one-run lead and could not hold it. So they will look to walk things off here as they check down to first, and Magno did not swing. So the count moves to 1-0, and the next pitch is swung on and popped high in the air on the left, or excuse me, the right side of the infield. As Ethan Mann, who has moved over to first base, will move under it and make the catch. So nothing doing for Matt Magno in that at-bat. And now Cal Campbell will step up. And look to get something, anything going for the Chinooks in the bottom of the ninth. And that one is swung on and missed, and a good pitch there. New pitcher for the Pilots as Hayden Walker will look to send this one into extras. And the 0-1 to Campbell is swung on and missed. And another good off-speed pitch there from Walker. And Campbell finds himself down 0-2. And the 0-2. Swing and a miss. Three straight fantastic off-speed pitches for Hayden Walker, and Campbell goes down swinging for the second out of the inning. So Will Batts representing the last chance for the Chinooks. If he can't get something going here, this game will go into extras. And for those of you who do not know, we do play international rules here, which means the team will start with a runner on second. Whoever had the last batted out will be the runner on second base. And so it'll go a little bit quicker than just normal innings, which for some is good and for some, you know, not very good. But I think it certainly helps with fatigue and in these really, really long extra inning games that end up happening. And that one swung on and missed. Good pitch there from Walker. And my goodness, that curveball is working right now. As Will Batts quickly has fallen behind 1-2. And you know he'd love to get a hold of one here and at least keep this inning alive for the Chinooks. And that one's downstairs. So the count moves to 2-2. And that one's also downstairs. Another off-speed pitch as Walker's certainly liking what he's seeing out of his off-speed right now. But Will Batts able to lay off, so the count is 3-2. I'm sorry, sir, what's not right? And Batts gets rung up! And my goodness, a late call there, but Will Batts gets rung up as he was already almost halfway down to first. But man, Will Batts gets rung up on that. So that'll be the third out of the inning, and so we will go to extras. All right, that makes sense, sir. I thought I said something wrong, but all right, yes, sir. So the Chinooks will now have to defend home court here as Justin Nevels, it appears, will take to the mound. So we will go to extras. So free baseball for you guys, even though the stream's already free. But some more free baseball for you guys. So we will take a quick break, and we will go back with the top of the 10th inning here on the Chinooks Radio Network. Now pitching for your Chinooks, a 5'8" freshman right-hander from Doan University and Chugiak, Alaska native, number 9, Justin Nevels. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as we have some free baseball for you. And once again, we do play international rules here in the ABL, so that means the last batted out for, the Pilots will be on second base. So that means Blake Wink will be on second base as he struck out to end the last inning for the Pilots. So he'll be on second base. So good speed for them there as Lopez squares around a bunt and he fouls it straight back towards our press box. So our partners over there on the other side of the press box probably were scattering. And so you will see this a lot in international rules. You'll see the guy bunt to try and get the runner over to third and just kind of trade an out for the run. And certainly if you're the away team, it's a good strategy as assuming that you can stop the home team from doing this something similar, you could walk off with a victory. As another bunt attempt is popped up, and this one will get into the crowd. So two bunt attempts for Lopez, and quite frankly, bunted kind of two lousy pitches, but I'm sure the Chinooks don't really care about that. Right now they're just worried about what's happening, and the count moves to 0-2. And just so everybody is aware, I'm not exactly the biggest fan of international rules either, but I do see their purpose as, you know, trying to save arms, make games a little faster, kind of with players' health and safety in mind. They don't want games going 15, 16, 17 innings and all these guys having to be used, especially in long 162-game seasons and limited amount of players on a roster, limited number of pitchers that you can have. So certainly, I understand their purpose. And Wink takes off. And that is grounded over to John Mark Mullins. So Devin Lopez started that at-bat off looking like it was going to be rough for him, but he's able to, at the very least, do his job and move Blake Wink over to, move Blake Wink over to third base no matter how long it took. And so now the infielder's in Kiel once again as Nick Hagedorn will step up to the plate with a chance for the Pilots to take a 3-2 lead. And that one swung on and missed. Good pitch there from Justin Nevels and a good block back there from Matt Magno. Keeps that ball in front of him. And so the count moves to 0-1, and I cannot understate how big this strikeout would be, or at least this out would be, for the Chinooks. As if you can keep that runner on third and retire Hagedorn, that takes a lot of weapons away from the Pilots. No ground ball to the middle infield will score a run. No sac fly. You'd have to hit him in. So certainly a big spot for the Pilots here. And the 1-1 from Nevels is upstairs. So two off-speed pitches in a row and didn't quite get that late break he was looking for on either one of them. So the count moves to 2-1. And the 2-1 from Nevels is just outside. So the count moves to 3-1. Good hitter's count for Hagedorn. And again, wouldn't be the worst thing in the world to walk him here, as you may still have the double play intact. But certainly you don't want to put a lot more guys on base, especially in extras, as every base runner and every run matters. So we'll see what Nevels goes with here, as that one's turned and ripped down the right field line. But I'm sure Nevels will take that, as that's just a foul ball. So a 3-2 count here, as this is the intensity is in the air. Certainly you can feel it as every pitch gets more and more agonizing for both sides. So we will see what Nevels comes with on his first 3-2. Is swung on and fouled off. Good spoil from Hagedorn as that ball appeared to be pretty high, chest high or higher, I would say. And he's able to foul that one off. And Nevels battling here in a huge battle with Hagedorn with one out in extras. And another 3-2 is swung on and tapped to second. And that runner cannot advance. So a huge out for Justin Nevels as he keeps that run from scoring, at least so far. And that'll be the second out of the inning. So now it is up to Ethan Mann to get that run across. And he has been one of the better hitters for the Pilots so far this season, if not their very best. So certainly good guy to go with. And, well, they're going to put him on again. So another intentional walk. And that is actually the second time they have chosen to do that. And it worked out for them the first time. And so Connor McGuire will get a chance at redemption here with runners on the corners and two outs here in extras. And I cannot begin to understate how important this at-bat is for the outcome of this ball game. If the Chinooks can get out of this without giving up a run, that is absolutely huge, as they will get international rules in the bottom half of this inning as well with a chance to walk it off. So certainly a huge moment here for both sides. And as a player, this is exactly what you live for on both sides. As a pitcher, to get out of a jam. As a hitter, to deliver with two outs. So we will see how this battle commences here. And the first pitch is in the dirt. Good block from Magno. So the count moves to 1-0. And Nevels gets the pitch he wants and fires the 1-0. That's upstairs. So now the count moves to 2-0 on Connor McGuire. And a good hitter's count for him here. And again, you don't want to put too many guys on base, as every run matters here. And if the Pilots are able to get one into the gap and two runs score, it's going to be much more difficult for the Chinooks in the bottom half. So we'll see what Nevels goes with on 2-0, and he gives him a fastball, and that one's popped high in the air, perhaps playable in foul territory, and it is, and Joe Brazil makes the catch. Justin Nevels pitches a scoreless top of the 10th. Ladies and gentlemen, I cannot understate how important that is, as now the Chinooks will get international rules in the bottom half of the inning with a chance to walk it off here in the bottom of the 10th, as we will head there momentarily right after this quick break. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as we are entering the bottom of the 10th. So extras here at Lee Jordan Field. But the good news for the Chinooks is they were able to escape the top of the 10th without allowing a run, despite international rules. So what that means is the Chinooks will now get international rules in the bottom half of the inning with a chance to walk it off, and they have a good guy on base to do it, as Will Batts will be the guy on second base, and Jean-Marc Mullins, the batter. So we will see if they go for the conservative route to bunt here, and they do not. As Jean-Marc Mullins rips it into left, and it's caught in left field. And Will Batts may be doubled off, and he is! And a huge play for the Pilots as Will Batts got too aggressive on the base paths, and he is picked off at second, try to get back. And oh, man, you cannot understate how crushing a blow that is for the Chinooks here. And now John Graham will have to start this inning all over with no one on base. And my goodness, an unfortunate circumstance for the Chinooks. But either way, John Graham pops this one up, perhaps playable behind first. And Ethan Mann will not get there as that one hits off the top of the fence. And he takes a tumble, but he appears to be all right. So John Graham down in the count 0-1 here. So two outs now with no one on base. And that one's downstairs. So John Graham looking to get things started back up for the Chinooks against Hayden Walker, who has looked very good since coming into the ball game in the ninth. And that one swung on and tapped foul down the right field line. And out of play. So the count moves to 1-2. And that one is tapped over to short. Devin Lopez will fire on to first and make the play. And we will head to another inning of international rules. And so the Pilots will have another chance to take the lead as we will head to the top of the 11th inning. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as Cole Escher will lead things off in this one for the Pilots, and they have another golden chance to take the lead here. The Chinooks were able to get out of this last time, so we'll see if they can pull another rabbit out of their hat. As Josh Harrell, one of the primary late-inning guys for the Chinooks, takes the mound, and he throws a curveball in there for strike one. So Connor McGuire at second base, not exactly familiar with his speed or lack thereof, not sure where he sits on that, so we'll have to see how this one plays out. And the 0-1 to Cole Escher's outside. And That one way outside. You could see Harrell kind of falling off the mound there a little bit. So might have been a result of pulling across there. So the count moves to 1-1. And that one is ripped into left field for a base hit. McGuire going to be held at third as Graham fields that one and throws it in. So Cole Escher with a base hit, and now there are runners on the corners with nobody out here in the top of the 11th. So Chinooks coming dangerously close to giving up the tie here, although at this point that might just be a formality. So we'll see how they play this, and it looks like they're still in Kiel. So the So the infield's still in Kiel, so they are not playing for the double play here. So we'll see how this strategy plays out. And now Alec Jones will step up to the plate. He's 1-for-4 so far tonight. That one is swung at and ripped straight back.
That foul ball brought to you by God Guns and Auto.
Oh my goodness, and what a jump from Cole Escher as he picked that bag about as clean as you could pick it. He was moving before the pitch was even going. So that is certainly a stolen base. So now double play out of the question. And it's going to be interesting to see how they attack Alec Jones now with the base open. Perhaps they'll be a little more careful with their pitch selection. With the base open. So the count moves to 2-1. And Harrell was on the mound the last time the Chinooks were in international rules. And he ended up, unfortunately, taking the loss. As that one is upstairs. So certainly we'll look to have a better performance in this one. But it is not looking good so far. As the count moves to a great hitter's count in 3-1 for Alec Jones. And at this juncture, one single may bust this game wide open. So we'll see what Harrell goes to attack here. And the 3-1 is upstairs. So a walk. And again, not the worst thing in the world considering the situation, as now there is a force play at every base. So that means that the Chinooks can just throw home, tag the base, and prevent the run from scoring on a ground ball. But again, that does insinuate that a ground ball has been hit, which is not at all a guarantee here. So now with bases loaded and no one out, Devin Ornelas is in the game, and that pitch is upstairs. Man, that looked like a pretty good pitch from here, but again, I don't have that great of view. So that's ball one. And the 1-0 is upstairs again. So Josh Harrell struggling to find the strike zone here, and at this point, the count moves to 2-0. And that one is also upstairs. So three really close pitches, and Harrell doesn't get any of them. And this is turning into a disastrous inning right now for the Chinooks. Still have a good chance, if Harrell can get the ball over the zone, that they can at least work a little bit of magic. And the 3-0 is upstairs again. So a four-pitch walk. And so that will walk in a run with nobody out here in the inning, and the base is still loaded. As Fausto Lopez will swing here. He came in as a pinch runner in the eighth and has gotten two at-bats already tonight in the designated hitter spot, as Harrell will stay in the game.
Sunday for the final game of this three-game series against the Glacier Pilots, sponsored by Bill Stoll.
So now Fausto Lopez will step up with a chance to really bust this game wide open as Harrell throws that one inside. And, man, nowhere to put him right now for Josh Harrell as he is all around the strike zone and simply just cannot get anything. And at this point, surely Chinooks will want him to throw a 60-mile-an-hour fastball in there. And that one's in there for a called strike. So sign of life for Harrell and the Chinooks here as this inning has started to get away from them. But again, if they are able to get a couple of ground balls and execute, they might just be able to get out of this inning with just the one run given up. That one is swung on and tapped into the center field for a base hit. And that will not happen as two runs are going to come around to score. And the Chinooks now find themselves down 5-2. With still nobody out here in the top of the 11th. And wow, how quickly things turn around as the Chinooks, it's hard to believe, it's at one point this game, the Chinooks were winning 2-0 very late in this ball game. And now they find themselves down 5-2, having only allowed 4 hits. And that one is also not there for ball one. As Blake Wink will grab a bat once again. And the 1-0 from Harrell is in there for a called strike. And Wink, again, did not like that. And this inning has certainly turned disastrous for the Chinooks. But still a chance to get out of this without the game completely getting away from them, as that one is swung on and tapped foul. And it's amazing. It doesn't feel like it's the same game as what was happening before, but at one point in this ball game, Nelson Schutte had gone 6 2/3 of no-hit baseball in this one. And unfortunately, it does not look like he's going to get rewarded, as clearly he won't get the win in this one. But he might not even get a team victory if this inning doesn't get under control quickly. And the 1-2 downstairs. So the count moves to 2-2. And Harrell's 2-2 is upstairs. So the count moves full, as Harrell has thrown a lot of pitches in this inning already. And a 3-2, and they might have him. And he gets back safely. And certainly a rambunctious crowd tonight. A little bit more rambunctious than I think we've had so far. But granted, that might just be because of the game situation. But either way, Harrell fires in his 3-2. And that one is swung on and missed. And that is a strike him out, throw him out, double play. And so a big turn of events for the Chinooks. As now they have a chance to, at the very least, get out of this inning and keep the lead where it is. So now with two outs, Devin Lopez will swing for the Pilots and hope to get that run home from second and add on to this lead. And that one is inside for ball one. And that one's upstairs. So the 1-0 misses up. So the count moves to 2-0 on Devin Lopez. Devin Lopez so far 0-5 tonight. So certainly a tough night for him at the plate. But he did reach on an error in the eighth inning. And that resulted in a run scoring. Or at least it was one of the reasons that the run scored in that inning. As the Chinooks had three errors in the eighth inning. So all three errors you see on the scoreboard were all in that one inning. And boy, that run certainly looked certainly very important now looking back. The count is 3-0 on Devin Lopez. And the runner takes off for third, and that one flies into left field. And so Fausto Lopez will score on the wild throw. And so now the score moves to 6-2. That pitch was in there for a called strike, by the way. So now the count moves to 3-1 on Lopez. And that one is outside. So another walk. And Devin Lopez will take his base. And that will probably be it for Josh Harrell in this one, so certainly a rough go for him. And hopefully he's not too hard on himself, and hopefully his teammates aren't too hard on him, as certainly a tough scenario that he had to work with. And now Nate Hemrick will look to stop the bleeding here, and the top of the 11th. All right, so Nate Hemrick tasked with stopping the bleeding for the Chinooks, and he has done a good job out of the pen so far this year. So there is a runner on first, and two outs. Chinooks down by four. this one is in there for a called strike. It's really, at this point, hard to tell where the strike zone is. But it is what it is. So the count moves to 0-1 on Nick Hagedorn. And that one is ripped into center field, and Will Batts coming on, and he cannot make the catch. That one drops in front of him. Came at it as hard as he could, just couldn't get there. So that'll be a base hit for Nick Hagedorn, his first hit of the game. And now Ethan Mann will step up here with two outs. And Ethan Mann now pretty much has to be pitched to. And the first pitch to him is outside. Count moves to 1-0. And the 1-0 is swung on and missed. Good pitch from Hemrick, and he gets back even. So the count moves to 1-1. And certainly you just hate to see, if you can see the scoreboard here at home, five hits, six runs. So certainly not something you see every day. And it has to be tough for the pitching staff. As that one's outside, as the defense has been pretty much rock solid all year, and certainly in a few ways has let them down so far today. But everybody, you know, it happens sometimes. I mean, you can't be perfect every day. You can't be amazing every day. And this just kind of goes to show that sometimes, you know, you have bad days. That's just how it goes in the business of baseball. Certainly, as an offensive player, you have a lot more bad days than you have good days. So the count moves to 3-1 on Ethan Mann, as I'm sure he'll look to do some damage here. And that one's in there for a called strike. So the count moves full on Ethan Mann. So Nate Hemrick looking to get himself out of the inning with this 3-2 pitch here. And the runner is going, and that one is in there for a called strike three. So Ethan Mann strikes out looking. And so the Chinooks finally get out of the inning, but my goodness, a lot of damage done as they gave up four runs on just two hits. So now they will move to the bottom of the 11th with international rules, but they have a lot of work to do as the Chinooks trail 6-2. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back here live on the Chinooks Radio Network here on YouTube as John Graham will be on second base in this international rule extra inning play, and Hayden Keller will have a tough lefty-lefty matchup against Hayden Walker, so the battle of the Haydens here. And Hayden Walker has pitched two fantastic innings in this one as Allen's in there for a called strike, so... The Chinooks have a lot of work to do in this inning as they gave up four in the top half of the inning, so certainly in huge danger of letting this game slip through their fingers, and that one is upstairs. That one just missed. And what's good for the Pilots, at least in this scenario, is they have a... They can pretty much have the luxury of just going after hitters and not really feeling in danger of blowing this lead. They can probably be a little bit more aggressive in the strike zone than they otherwise might be if the game was closer in at this juncture. So we'll see if that plays out here. And that one is upstairs. So not as of right now. So the count moves to 3-1 after they checked the swing and they said no swing. So the count moves to 3-1. And you know, Hayden would love to get a hold of one here and get some momentum at least for the Chinooks. And he swings, and that one's fouled straight back. So good swing there from Keller, and he's had some good swings tonight. He's 2-for-4 so far. He had an RBI triple in the top of the third. He also singled in the first. And the full count to him is, oh, hey now. Way up and in. And so Hayden Keller will take a walk. All right, so Kobe Ferris will step up to the plate now for the Chinooks with two on and nobody out. And Kobe Ferris is 1-for-4 so far today. And, you know, he'd love to deliver here as that one is upstairs. And suddenly Little is just a little bit wild here. And I'm sure the Chinooks will take that, as this is pretty much how things started for the Pilots in the last inning. Chinooks having to work the count now and get Little to throw a lot of pitches. And it's worked so far as the count moves to 2-0 as that pitch was well inside. And the 2-0 to Ferris is swung on and popped up high in the air down foul territory as the third baseman Connor McGuire will come up to make the catch for out number one. And honestly, at this point in the game, I'm not sure I'd swing at that pitch if I was Colby, but he did. And the Chinooks will have to live with that decision now, as Paige Fullerton steps up to the plate, looking to keep things going for the Chinooks. And the 0-0 to Fullerton is in there for a called strike. Fullerton having a good night so far. He's 1-for-3 with a walk. So certainly performed well with the bat, and that one's in there for a called strike too. Good pitch from Little. Or excuse me, from Little. I don't know who Little is, because he's certainly not Little. Hayden Walker, I don't know where I got that name from. But the 0-2 to Fullerton is outside. Not a bad pitch at all from Hayden Walker. I apologize for just saying the random name. It's been a long night for all of us here, so that one's outside. So the count now moves to 2-2 as Paige Fullerton looks to keep battling, keep this inning going, get on base in any way he can, give the Chinooks a chance. Whatever superlatives you want to use, that's what he's looking to do here in the 2-2. It swung on and missed. Good pitch from Hayden Walker, and that will be out number two. So the Chinooks running out of chances as they're down to their last out, still down by four. And now Joe Brazil representing the final opponent for Hayden Walker. And the first pitch to Brazil is swung on and missed. Big swing from him, didn't connect. So the count moves to 0-1. And the 0-1 is upstairs. Not a bad pitch from Walker, but good take from Brazil. As he'll look to keep the inning going for the Chinooks here with two outs, two on, down by four. And the 1-1. Swung on and tapped to short. Lopez will fire on to first, and that throw is too high. So the Chinooks have a little bit of life here as the throwing error from Devin Lopez at short will keep the game alive for Matt Magno, who doubled in his first at-bat, but since then has not looked particularly great. He's grounded out to first base and popped out twice. So, you know, Matt would love to get one into the gap, keep this thing going for the Chinooks. But the first pitch is well outside. And that one is in there for a called strike one. And certainly a rambunctious crowd here tonight, trying to get behind the Chinooks, and the 1-1 to Magno swung on and missed. So Hayden Walker one strike away from putting away the Chinooks tonight. And Matt Magno looking to keep battling, keep the inning going. And so we'll see what Walker goes to attack Magno here. And the 1-2 is swung on and fouled off. Tapped back over behind the plate. So Magno stays alive for at least one more pitch. As Hayden Walker looking to finish the job, can Magno stay alive? And he taps that one to the mound. And Hayden Walker will throw on to first, and the Anchorage Glacier Pilots came from behind to win this one by a score of 6-2, and a crushing defeat for the Chinooks as they had this game well in hand for most of this ball game, and a late game collapse pretty much sealed their fate. And you look at the scoreboard, the Chinooks actually out-hit the Pilots, which is interesting considering the run differential in this one. But, you know, sometimes that's baseball. But either way, the Pilots grab a huge win here as the Chinooks now fall to second place, albeit by just a half a game, but it still counts. So the Chinooks fall to second place in the ABL. And so the next ball game for the Chinooks will be Sunday afternoon against these Pilots here at Lee Jordan Field at 2 p.m., so 2 p.m. start time, at least 2 p.m. Alaska time, 6 p.m. Eastern time. So the Chinooks have a day off tomorrow, and I'm sure that they will love to take one after losing a tough game like that. So from all of us here to all of you at home, I would like to thank all of you for watching. Thank you to all of the guests that came in here for interviews today. Thank you, Justin Estrada, Joe Kiel, Paddy McKermitt, Sean Parnell, the former governor and UAA, now current UAA chancellor, and pitching coach Troy Hervey. So thank them all for coming in here. So again, from all of us to all of you at home, I'd like to thank you so much for joining us tonight, and we will see you all very soon.